I just wanted to talk about rhinos for today and the documentary that you're that's coming up.
Sure.
So in India, in the beginning of the 20th century, there were around a few hundred rhinos left. And because of the work of, you know, conservationists and activists, now there are more than 3,000. But, you know, even in India, they still remain vulnerable. So why do you think preserving them is the need of the hour? Like, why did you take this initiative up?
The rhino is a keystone species. So for ecosystems to thrive, for ecosystems to develop, and for ecosystems to stay stable, you need to keep keystone species within the environment, and you need to keep them on the planet. I mean, you think about the herbivores, you think about the carnivores, you start getting rid of herbivores, you got to start getting rid of some carnivores, you start getting rid of some grazers, you start getting rid of the treetop feeders, then you start messing around with ecosystems. And with that being said, you then end up with an absolute catastrophe of not just losing, say, the rhino, but you start losing some of the browsers, you start losing some of the other animals, you start losing insects, you start losing all sorts in the ecosystem. So there's a big, big play here to protect keystone species.
Also, you know, if this continues, like the way the poaching and everything is continuing, when do you think they'll become extinct? Like,
well, I mean, you have a look at India at the moment, and the conservation project that is up in Kaziranga, where we filmed the documentary, it is a global leader in protecting rhino. They are doing the most wonderful job. They are proactive. They are brilliant people. They understand and care for their animal. It's a symbol of Assam. And the only thing that's really hurting the animals as much as it's hurting the humans is when the Brahmaputra River floods every single year. That's a catastrophe for both animal and human. But in terms of protecting the animals, they are doing such a fabulous job. And as I said, they are a leader in the world of conservation, particularly the rhino.
You talk about the floods. Now, the thing is, the maximum of the rhinos are in the Kaziranga National Park. So,
yes,
you know, while they're doing an amazing job, the concentration of the population there in one national park is also dangerous, don't you think? Because, like, one, there's overcrowding. You know, that's like a burden on the resources there. And also when, you know, such natural disasters happen, or when there's a disease that wipes out the entire population, that can be catastrophic in that way, don't you think?
It can be catastrophic, but they are relocating rhinos to Manas National Park because they have got too many rhino in Kaziranga National Park. So because of the success and because of how many animals that they do have, they are relocating to Manas National Park. So the big issue in Kaziranga National Park is the highways that goes through the national park too. But there are a number of animal corridors where when the rain comes and the river starts to flood, the animals do use those corridors to get up to the higher mountains and into the higher hills. But yes, naturally there is going to be a couple of animals that unfortunately don't make it up into the higher mountains and succumb, just like the humans. There's a lot of humans that lives get taken because of the flooding, but they do their best in the situation. And I think we tell the most beautiful, beautiful story about one of the most gorgeous places, not just in India, but in the world. And I think India is going to be so proud of what they see on Tuesday, when you see how positive it is, you see how beautiful it is, you see how successful it is. And for me to be able to tell that story is the greatest gift that I could ever give back to India, because I've been lucky enough to profit with friends. I've profited financially. I've profited emotionally. I've had so much good time in India, and it's made me an all-rounded person and a better person. And so to be able to say to India, well, thank you for everything, and I'd like to show your country off to the world with this positive story, is something that just, honestly, it just makes me smile.
Also, could you shed some light on, Sorai, like your initiative for rhinos? So what do you do and what do you intend to do?
Yes, Sorai stands for Save Our Rhino Africa and India. It's a brand that cares about conservation. It's a brand that I launched a few years ago. It was really successful. I've now, over the last 18 months, built the most wonderful global team, and we're going to relaunch the brand in a couple of weeks. And we donate 20% of all of our profits to Care for Wild in South Africa on the global stage. And then in India, we're going to be donating 20% of all our profits and all our sales to the Center for Wildlife Studies in Bangalore. And they look at human-wildlife conflict. And I believe that Krithi Karanth down there in Bangalore and all the national parks that they do conserve and look after do the most fabulous job. So to be able to give back is something that... is again pleasing.
Right. Also, you know, the ongoing pandemic that right now, I mean, like the world is grappling to deal with it. Also, do you think that's affected the work of conservationists, like because the lockdown? I mean, most countries around the world have gone into lockdown.
So tourism has taken a hit, and one of the biggest financial donors that tourism funds is conservation and anti-poaching and security and fences. So the one good thing associated to the fact that they haven't been able to pay for the anti-poaching, well, not pay, but money's running out for anti-poaching, maintenance is not a priority. The freedom of movement of people is also halted. So the poachers are not coming into the countries. The Chinese are not sending their entourages in and around anywhere. No one can travel at the moment. So without that travel, poaching has actually gone down significantly, especially in South Africa. So in a way, it's been a good thing. But in terms of the crisis that the globe sits itself in at the moment, we need to stop the illegal wildlife trade because it's what got us into this situation in the first place.
Absolutely. Also, just a fun question. So your fellow cricketer, Rohit Sharma, he's also like an animal enthusiast. I mean, I remember we did a story last year on how he joined a campaign, like a similar campaign in Kenya in 2015, I think. So have you guys ever talked about this or, you know, maybe thought about collaborating for this? For this cause.
I have. I've spoken to Rohit a lot about it. I actually sent him the documentary yesterday to watch because he was begging me. He was like, I want to see it. I'm desperate to see it. I sent him the trailer a couple of weeks ago and he said, I'm so desperate to see it. I really want to see it. So I actually sent it to him last night. So luckily for Rohit, he's going to see it before everybody else.
That's great. Also, do you remember any particular incident, like during your journey as like a rhino conservationist and, you know, your work? Do you remember any particular incident that really touched you and, you know, urged you to move forward with this?
Yeah, I mean, it can sometimes get really tiring asking people to support, asking people to donate, banging the drum. People can get really tired of it. But you know what? When you do it for a long time, there are certain moments that make you recommit and give you that energy to just keep going. And I've been unlucky enough, or you could maybe say lucky enough, to give me the energy to keep going, to walk into quite a few dead rhino sightings where the animals have just been killed and they're performing the forensics on the animal and the day before it was shot. And the smell is something that will stick with you. You will never, ever forget that smell. It is horrendous. And so you can get tired of it. You can get really, for beating the conservation drum can be tiresome. But the energy that I get whenever I run into something like that or hear a story of a ranger that's been shot or one of my mates who's had a near miss with a poaching syndicate, it gives you the energy to keep going, to say, we've got to stop this.
Right. So that's all the number of questions that I came up with because I wanted to focus on the rhinos and the conservation bit more than anything else.
Thank you very much.
So, yes, thank you so much for speaking to me.